Thanks to Linode for supporting this SciShow video. You can get a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account at linode.com/scishow. In the early 1990s, researchers in the UK began clinical trials using a drug called sildenafil to treat chest pain. It didn't turn out to be particularly promising for that purpose, but subjects reported an unexpected side effect that caught the researchers' attention. They began focusing on that instead, and in 1998, the FDA approved sildenafil for sale under the brand name Viagra. This isn't the only time that a drug has been repurposed because of useful side effects. In fact, it might be about to happen again, but this time we may be honing in on a treatment for addiction. Our star today is a medication called semaglutide, which you may be familiar with by its brand names, Ozempic and Wegovy. The two brands are the same active compound, but at different doses, and they also have different uses. Ozempic was originally approved by the FDA in 2017 to treat type 2 diabetes, and Wegovy was approved in 2021 for what doctors refer to as chronic weight management. After semaglutide was approved for weight management, the drug skyrocketed in popularity, which turned out to be kind of a problem because people who'd been taking it for years to treat their diabetes were all of a sudden having trouble getting their hands on it due to supply shortages. But as more people began taking semaglutide, some of them also began reporting that once they started taking Ozempic, they were no longer all that interested in drinking alcohol. Even those who had self-reported addictive tendencies or unhealthy fixations on alcohol suddenly felt craving stop, just like that. And that isn't quite as far out of left field as it sounds once you understand exactly how semaglutide works. Semaglutide mimics a naturally occurring hormone called glucagon, like peptide 1 or GLP-1, that's released primarily in the gut after eating and raises insulin levels to stabilize your blood sugar. Semaglutide is only one of many medications that mimic GLP-1, and the first of these drugs was approved in 2005. They work by binding with receptors in the pancreas to stimulate insulin production. Plus, they can also slow down how quickly your stomach empties, which leaves you feeling fuller for longer. The entire class of drugs is actually named after those receptors the hormone binds with, not the hormone itself. So they're called GLP-1 receptor agonists. It's the insulin-boosting effect that GLP-1 receptor agonists capitalize on to treat diabetes. The increased feeling of fullness means less appetite and fewer cravings for high-fat foods, which can result in weight loss. Even though GLP is mostly released in the gut, there are GLP-1 receptors throughout the body, including areas of the brain typically associated with reward and addiction. And so scientists have studied various GLP-1 agonists to see how they might affect addictive behaviors. In mice, rats, and even non-human primates, giving an animal a GLP-1 agonist reduces how much alcohol they drink and decreases the rewarding effects of drinking alcohol. And in other animal studies, those GLP-1 agonists have also been shown to decrease cocaine consumption, cocaine-related hyperactivity, and dopamine release in reward-related areas of the brain. Rodent studies also show decreased rewarding effects of nicotine as well as decreased nicotine-induced hyperactivity. In other words, this class of drugs may make addictive substances less desirable by blunting the effects and making them less rewarding. That's different from the current treatments that make you feel sick when you take drugs or drink alcohol so you stop doing it. These GLP-1 agonists appear to actually be changing how much of a dopamine hit comes from the addictive substance, although scientists don't yet know exactly how they interact with that dopamine. But there still aren't many human studies on GLP-1 and addiction that have been completed yet, and almost none involve semaglutide specifically. One of those few human studies found that one GLP-1 receptor agonist reduced alcohol use in patients who were obese, but not in patients who weren't. As of June 2023, there have only been a handful of studies published that specifically look at semaglutide and addiction. Those studied rodents, and they suggested semaglutide decreases alcohol intake and the activity of reward mechanisms in the brain, so they're really a promising start. But the jury's still out on whether GLP-1 receptor agonists in general will work to reduce addictive behaviors in clinical trials on humans. Semaglutide definitely seems to have an effect in people, but right now we only have anecdotal reports of reduced interest in drinking and other addictive behaviors. It's possible that this only happens in a small minority of people. It just feels like a lot right now because so many people have recently started taking it and we're paying attention to those reports. Plus, a lot of rodent testing has focused on short-term effects after getting a GLP-1 receptor agonist injection. That doesn't really tell us if a drug will continue to be effective for long-term treatment. And since substance use disorders are long-term chronic issues, that's an important question to answer too. Really, just about any question about addiction treatment is an important one. Addiction is incredibly difficult to treat. There are only a few medications on the market to treat some substance use disorders, and they don't work for everyone. And while a few drugs show promise, there are currently no approved medications for cocaine or methamphetamine addiction, so finding and approving new drugs could truly be a game changer. But we can't do that without human studies looking at semaglutide and substance use, which are currently underway. And if that doesn't work, an added bonus is that drugs already approved by the FDA for another condition are approved more quickly than brand new drugs. New drugs take years of animal and human safety testing to get the green light. With an already approved drug, the mechanism of how it works is already known, as are the side effects, which makes the whole process move faster. It even happened with Viagra in 2005, when the active ingredient was finally approved for pulmonary hypertension on a shorter timeline than it took to get the first one. Hopefully, the clinical trials of semaglutide are successful, and these anecdotal reports will be the first step towards more effective treatment of addiction. It could save a lot of lives and a lot of pain, all because a new drug happened to have very useful side effects. This episode of SciShow is supported by Linode, a cloud computing company from Akamai. Cloud computing is technology. I mean, it practically has the word computer in the name. But Linode has found ways to keep the human connection front and center, even in the tech world. Linode has award-winning customer support staff, so you can talk to a real person anytime, any day. Or you can check out their website full of video tutorials, blogs, and guides that explain the tech in plain language so you don't have to be a developer to understand what's going on. But the community of people who love Linode expands beyond their employees. As a Linode customer, you can communicate with other people just like you in forums to troubleshoot new applications and work together to achieve your goals. To get started with Linode, you can click the link in the description down below or go to linode.com/scishow for a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow.